Hello. In this lecture, I will try to discuss something on the topic of culture and imperialism in the context of the paper 204, that is post-colonial component. These two are Edward Said's terms. In fact, this is the title of a book. In a way, it can be called his second magnum opus, though this is exactly not the second book, not his second book, but this was the major book which was published after 1978, major by the standards of literature departments. In this book, he actually carried on the arguments that he offered in Orientalism to a further extent. One of the prime reasons is Orientalism was an unmasking, now masks are very important, of the functionings of the British colonial rule, which in many subtle ways are still continuing, but more importantly, the role of the British media, British scholarship had been overtaken by the American media, etc. CNN. So CNN is a major focus in culture and imperialism, the last chapter if you read. So, he updated his thesis in Orientalism, including the American component mainly, but that is one part. We'll come to the main part. Culture and imperialism. This is very closely related to the ideology video that I uploaded yesterday. Generally, in our day-to-day terms, what do we say? Culture is a different thing, and imperialism, which is part of politics, is a very different thing. So, during the British rule, many of us said, a fact that I referred to in my previous videos, that yes, the British imperialism is bad for us, but the British culture is very good. They quote-unquote civilized us. In fact, this civilizing mission, which the British government, missionaries, etc., they sold to us, was the mask of conquest. In fact, Gauri Vishwanathan has this wonderful book, Masks of Conquest, Literary Studies and British Rule in India. How the literary studies in India became a surrogate British man, both during and even after the British rule. Yes, it is man, because more of, it's more masculine or patriarchal, even today. Though we are including women writers, so the great canon, dead, white, male, European, Christian, and you can go on adding heterosexual, heteronormative, etc. So these all represent the ideology of a ruling class, a ruling community, we can say, extending Marx a little further anyway. So in this book, Said contradicts this idea that culture and imperialism are two different things. He says they are two sides of the same coin. So obviously, though he has not explicitly mentioned Marx to be his origin, he has mentioned Raymond Williams, who is nonetheless a Marxist critic. And it is understood, all people in critical theory, including Foucault, Gayatri Spivak, all of them have been Marxists directly or indirectly at some point of time, and later they moved on. And again, being Marxist is not also being communist. There is a difference between the two. Communism is the practical, programmatic aspect of Marxism, and it was finalized more by people like Lenin, Stalin, etc. And many of their things Marx himself would not have agreed to. Anyway, but Marxism as a philosophy, what does it teach us? It teaches us generally through its class struggle, ideology, all this. What are these in a word? In a sentence, if we may club all these things together, this is thinking against the grain, reading against the grain. You see something, there is a facade. So beyond that you have to see. It is very much like in our Indian culture, Indian tradition, specifically Hindu tradition, it is said that everything we say is illusion, unreal, but we see them as real. So it is the guru who gives you kind of the eyes to see the real thing beyond this phenomenal universe. So the guru opens our eyes. अज्ञान तिविरांधस्य ज्ञानांजन शलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः. Very ironically, Marx, Said, Foucault, they are gurus actually, because they, though the Indian guru thing is related to the kind of Parabrahman, that may well be again said to be an ideology in Marxist terms. In fact, in India also we had dissonances from people like Charvaka, Buddha, Jain, etc. Anyway, so Marx opened our eyes, made us see beyond the phenomenal existence. Yes, this has been a common theme all through, I know. Shakespeare also spoke about appearance and reality. But the approaches earlier were more individualistic. Marx developed a system which other critics carried on later. So, if you, you know, see it intelligently, Said's relating imperialism and culture is basically a very good and valid extension of the Marxist thesis of materiality of culture. Materiality or materialism, if we may say. So that is money. Money is the base of everything. Money means in our loose terms, but Marx meant ownership of the factors of production. The capitalist class, ruling class. So the kind of ideology they give is internalized by all. Anyway, so culture and imperialism, their side, starting with his praise of Raymond Williams, a great critic, he says, and a wonderful friend from whom I have learned many things, Said says. But then he finds Raymond Williams' criticism of English or British culture also to be limited because it remains confined within England, class. Said extends it to the colonies. That, what about the colonies? So, in doing so, he shows that the great, the so-called great culture or cultural artifacts, song, music, literature, he talks about operas, Verdi's Aida. All these great artifacts of European or English culture, they never stood or hardly ever stood in the way of imperialism. So how can we say that these are innocent? In fact, these cultural artifacts created, gave, or rather consolidated, to use Said's term, there is a chapter, I mean section called Consolidated Vision, Empire's Vision. These novels and all, they helped the empire to consolidate its vision. Well, he doesn't directly mean to say that literature caused imperialism, but much the same, it helped the spread of imperialism by all means and never stood in its way. And of all literary forms, well, I'll come to that later. I'll give you one example. You see, William Wordsworth, on whom we gave one lecture, and we'll give some more on the prelude, who is universally celebrated as the kind of the priest not only of nature but of humanism. He spoke against, I mean rather celebrated, spoke for French Revolution, for instance, that is 1789. But from 1757 onwards, the company had taken direct rule of India. Indians were treated just as slaves, as animals and all this. There's nothing, Wordsworth was very much aware of this. But there is nothing in Wordsworth against the atrocities of company's rule in India. The same with Dickens. We celebrate Dickens as a great humanist. All the sorrows and unhappiness of those chimney sweepers of England, the working class of England. But you know, the same Dickens was a shareholder in East India Company. If you even Google simply Charles Dickens and the Oriental race with these two words, you will come across striking revelations. In fact, Dickens had once commented the entire Orientals, that is we, the Chinese and the Middle East, you know, whatever is in the Oriental should be wiped out as a race. Dickens' written statement is there in a letter, if I remember correctly. So you check there. So perhaps the revenge is now being taken. Some Oriental countries done something that the entire Westerners are now, you know, being wiped out. The COVID I'm talking about. But anyway, this was only in a lighter vein. This is a great humanist crisis, the COVID, for all of us. But anyway, so even Dickens. So Dickens or Wordsworth, their humanism was only half-hearted, only for the Europeans, not for the colonies, if we may say so. Anyway, the side goes on further in this book, Culture and Imperialism, published in 1993. Orientalism, 1978, Culture and Imperialism, 1993. In some editions, 94 is shown as the first edition, but actually it is 93. And then, Said goes on further and finds that of all the cultural forms of European tradition, the novel is the most colonial or most imperial of all forms. And he gives an interesting thesis. I had discussed this in first semester actually in our 101 paper, that it is not coincidental or accidental that the growth of imperialism and the growth of novel in English and Euro, English culture and European culture, is very parallel, has close parallels. So we can say they are coterminous, to use a term from a legal statement. So why this is so? That means the novel was fostered by, promoted by the imperial worldview. So this is the post-colonial position. Said says, for instance, that it is not for nothing that the first English novel, that is the first English novel proper, there have been novels earlier, is Robinson Crusoe, which if you look at from post-colonial